Have you ever felt like the writing was on the wall? It means that it is just a matter of time before things are about to change and nothing can stop it. The first time this happened was during a Babylon bash when heaven sent a transmission to earth that only one man in biblical Iraq could unpack. The scenario of the writing on the wall happened in ancient Babylon just before its downfall, as it was under the rule of a rebellious son who decided to host a palace party with a bunch of his drinking buddies while his daddy was away on business. Have you ever heard the saying, while the cat's away, the mice will play? Wait a minute. Where does it say that in the Bible? Let's read Daniel chapter 5, 1 through 13. You know what? On second thought, while you read it in your Bible, I want to play a 2.5-minute clip from Pure Flix Entertainment that portrays perfectly what happened on that fateful day at Belshazzar's bash in Babylon.
Bring me the golden vessels from the Temple of Jerusalem.
But my king, is it wise to use the vessels?
My king,
these cups are considered sacred. Are they not my
king? Perhaps in Jerusalem! But here they are spoiled for our gods. And they would have me use them as I see fit. Bring them!
Yes. You see these vessels? In Jerusalem, they were used for the worship of their God. Now, instead of the blood of bulls and rams, let them flow with foaming wine. For I am not a devourer of blood. I am a devourer of drink. And choice fare.
To Marduk, the god of our city.
Marduk!
And to our idols of gold and silver, bronze and iron, wood and stone, partake of our pleasures and protect our city. Whoever reads this and tells me what it means shall be clothed in purple and have a gold chain placed around his neck and be made third highest ruler in the kingdom.
Now I want to focus on Daniel chapter 5, verse 7. The king called aloud to bring in the conjurers, the Chaldeans, and the diviners. The king spoke and said to the wise men of Babylon, any man who can read this inscription and explain its interpretation to me shall be clothed with purple and have a necklace of gold around his neck and have authority as third. And then it often has ruler in italics in most Bibles, but it doesn't actually have ruler in the original text. It says, and have authority as third in the kingdom. There is so much to unpack in this passage that took place in Babylon. To stand in the courtyard of one of the palaces that may have hosted this prophetic party was pretty awe-inspiring. I actually want to look at one ancient artifact that will help us understand why Belshazzar offered the position of third in the kingdom to whoever can help him understand the message. Did Belshazzar already have a vice king, or was the queen second in command? Now, I am holding in my hand what is called the Nabonidus Chronicle. Now, this is obviously a replica, but I just could not help myself from getting my hands on this replica of the ancient artifact that explains why Belshazzar could only offer the third position in the kingdom to whoever could unpack the message that crashed his bash. This clay tablet with this ancient cuneiform script has something to say. Now, the original was acquired by the British Museum in 1879 from an antiquities dealer. Its original place of discovery is thought to have come from the ruins of Babylon. There have been thousands of these type of clay tablets uncovered in dozens of archaeological sites all over Iraq. Once scholars began to decipher the cuneiform script, the tablets started speaking up, and what they say is astounding. Now, here is what this clay tablet says. Wait a second. Would you like to see the authentic ancient artifact housed at the British Museum in London that reminds me of Willy Wonka's chocolate factory? I told you in episode 2, I would bring you back to see some of these archaeological treats. Now, before I show it to you, though, there are two other artifacts that are going to help bring this clay chronicle to life. The first one is a stone stele discovered in Babylon of King Nabonidus, the last king of Babylon. Did you catch that? The description below the artifact says, here, Nabonidus, 556 to 539 BC, wears the traditional dress of a king of Babylon, holding objects symbolizing justice and power. Before him are the star of Ishtar, the winged disc of Shamash, and the crescent of the moon god Sin, to whom Nabonidus was personally devoted. What is really cool is that the words in the stele have been translated, though I will not bore you with what it says. But one important aspect of the text is that it primarily is talking about commerce, which was based on the value of a Babylonian shekel, which happens to also be the name of the past and present currency in Israel. The second important artifact is called the Nabonidus Cylinder. It is primarily talking about his building projects. But at the end he says, as for me, Nabonidus, king of Babylon, save me from sinning against your great Godhead and grant me as a present a life long of days. And as for Belshazzar, the eldest son, my offspring, instill reverence for your great Godhead in his heart, and may he not commit any cultic mistake. May he be sated with a life of plenitude. Before the discovery of this ancient cylinder, the cynics were convinced that Belshazzar was the figment of the imagination of the author of the book of Daniel. Hang on, my friend. It gets even better. The third and most important artifact is the Nabonidus Chronicle. So what does it say? It gives a chronological account of the reign of King Nabonidus, the last king of Babylon, who was the absentee father of Belshazzar. While Nabonidus reigned over the entire kingdom of Babylonia from Arabia, he placed his eldest son Belshazzar in charge of the city of Babylon. Did you catch that? The reason Belshazzar could only offer the third position of the kingdom is because his daddy Nabonidus was first, Belshazzar was second, and whoever could crack the code on the wall would be third in the kingdom. Somebody say, Biblical Iraq Unpacked. Now, since we're already looking at this passage in Daniel, and we are inside the treasure trunk of the British Museum that I call Willy Wonka's Chocolate Factory, there is one more display of artifacts that sheds light on how Daniel became the Babylon spelling bee champ. I'm going to add a bonus episode for all of our free members of BFAinternational.com. Hey, it's free. All you have to do is create a username and password and you're good to go. Oh, and I already added a bonus episode from episode 3 titled Abraham's Apartment Complex. Not to mention, but I will. We have a boatload of other great good presentations for our free members that have received great reviews. So what are you waiting for? I'm calling the bonus episode the Babylon Spelling Bee. I have to say, once I started connecting the dots between ancient artifacts and long-lost locations, my Bible began to morph into a treasure map that leads me beyond the borders to places like Biblical Iraq. The challenge is to decide what to unpack. Our next Biblical Iraq Unpacked episode that will be available for everyone, everywhere, is titled A Messiah from Persia. Shh. This one is a bit touchy. I guess I should also mention discreetly that the Iraq Unpacked Plus episode that is exclusively for our Academy Premium Content Library members of BFAInternational.com is titled The Wild West in the Middle East. You got to be tracking with us in the Plus Sensitive Events series to appreciate this one. Okay, my friends, that's all for now. But that's not all for later.